It seemed as though Regin had been ready to take up arms and slay people like Hamilton. Could he have committed murder for his cause? Who could have gotten killed in front of his very eyes? It was so cold. Already Carl did not feel his toes anymore. Carl suddenly felt observed. He was worried about a presence around him. No stone can withstand the force of dynamite.
Thank you.
A shiver ran down Carl's spine as he glanced over another body trapped in ice. Indeed, the scene was quite chilling. Carl felt familiar shivers going down his spine, and he was back to the realm of visions. To all appearances, this was a hunting log. Better yet, a war diary. What could these engraved numbers mean? A fresh path suddenly appeared before Carl. The vision slowly faded away, like an icicle melting in the palm of your hand. Carl, back in the real world, now knew who the icebound man was. Gilles Lachance, the general store's manager himself. That had to be the worst parking job ever. Who was Carl to judge, though? It may be customary to park like that around these parts, or not. Carl knew why he was suddenly shivering. He was going back to the realm of visions. Carl had no issue recognizing the spirit-like figures, but he couldn't figure out what they wanted from him. The phantom, freed of reality's shackles, vanished in the forest. Earlier, Carl had witnessed a tragedy that befell it. Another phantom disappeared in the wilderness. Carl had seen what happened to it, too. A third phantom gently faded away. Carl noticed that as the cursed villagers finally left reality, he could feel a sense of unburdening exuding from them in an almost intimate way. The last phantom, lost in solitude up until now, joined the others in the forest's darkness, free at last to enjoy an eternal, well-deserved slumber. Carl was only beginning to understand the horror which had struck his village. He understood that the dead were piling up and that he couldn't help them by himself. The road was clear for him. He needed to push further north and fast to find help. Another diary. Carl felt like someone was trying to communicate with him. Or was it simply the result of happenstance? Carl was becoming increasingly convinced that this was not normal hunting. The game that was being tracked was fearsome, so much so that the hunter didn't dare approach it. What could it be? Carl had found what he was looking for. He needed to get back on the road. A quick glance at the scene was enough for Carl to know that a fight had taken place here. The visitors must not have sold their skin so easily, literally. Carl reckoned that the place was still inhabited less than 24 hours ago. His detective sense tingled, revealing to him, or was it the strong smell of wilderness in the air, that there were most likely two men. Pierre the Poacher Bleh was definitely not the one who lived here. Indeed, Carl learned earlier that the man had recently been shredded to death by, allegedly, beasts. There should be a rifle hanging there. Its owner may not be very far. Two blankets. There were doubtless two people here, Carl reckoned. The jacket was still soaking wet. The poor man had, surely unwillingly, had a taste of the pond's water not too long ago. According to the pay stub, that poor man was Alexandre Blais. The door was unlocked. Carl felt kind of disappointed that he wouldn't have to solve the mystery of that padlock. Scratches did not stop Carl. His mother would be so proud. The door had been busted down violently, and a burnt smell filled the air. Half of the cabin had been consumed by flames. Carl surveyed the chaotic scene, noticing that someone appeared to have intended to use the furniture as bonfire fuel. Carl had no idea how such a mess could have occurred, but he knew it didn't bode well. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. Seems like this place was long deserted. Just one more move for Black to checkmate White. Two more victims of this ice plague. Carl felt a chill down his spine. What if he was next? Strong pull of a vision overcome him. It looked like a simple hunting accident. There was Hamilton. Carl recognized him. A major hunting accident. The doctor examined the young woman. Death couldn't be overturned. She was dead. It was not the type of body you buried in a big ceremony in the village graveyard. It had to be hidden. No one could know about this. The best way to do that was to have a simple-minded man bury the poor girl. Lamotte, the mechanic. The doctor denied the unfair death of the young woman, but Hamilton had him in his grips. Hamilton knew all of the poet's secrets and wouldn't hesitate to reveal them. I know all about your crimes, you little communist. You know mine. What a sordid affair. Understood the ins and outs of the affair. A woman had been killed in an unfair accident, and a young warrior had damned himself to avenge her. something, the one responsible had already been killed, and so the beast could not quench its thirst for vengeance. And now, recklessly, Carl had pulled the bolt from the beast's heart. A beast who was but a young free man lost without his fiancée, and who had, out of hatred, become Wendigo. Carl, like many of his contemporaries, felt like he had more trouble breathing when he wasn't smoking. Cigarette was his own personal breathing assistant. It sheltered him, but for how long? Disappeared, so did purity. I would defend purity against the winds, the tides, against ice and blizzard. Could it be that all this was but a story of justice and vengeance? The soulful doctor, avenging his fiancée's unjust death by avenging this young woman as though she was his lover. Are these passionate feelings not precisely the kind of feelings that could cause a storm, petrify people deep inside, create monsters?
Un survivant ? On a trouvé un survivant !